Hi folks, this is Jay. How are you doing? I hope everybody's okay today. We're having a Google Hangout on the false conflict between science and faith, and I have a good friend of mine, Mark, and we've done some really good videos together, and he's done some great videos. But before I introduce Mark, I just want to say one or two things. I said I made a video. I didn't actually speak in it, but I just put some trumpet playing where I said I was stepping down, but I feel that I can do videos that will be a help to people. And if people want to use those videos, that's great. So I'm going to be continue to do videos if people want me around and want to use the stuff and talk with me. True in person wants to do some chats with me as well. The second thing is I chatted with a gay guy the other day. We were supposed to have a chat tonight. And I'm going to put a link to the guy's channel, and you can go down and have a look at the guy's channel and find out a bit about him. So over to you, Mark. Any thoughts about this topic? And thanks for coming to chat, mate. Love you, bro. And just trust that God will be with us. Before we start, I just wondered if we could have a prayer, if you could pray.
Dear God, thank you for this night, Lord. Thank you for your grace and for your peace and for your joy. Thank you for our minds. Thank you for your gospel. Lord, we just pray for your presence to be with us this night. In Jesus' name, lead us into all truth, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Okay, Mark.
Hey there, Jay.
I don't know if you want to go first. I've got
the sound's gone off a bit here.
Can you hear me?
I can't hear you.
Can you hear me? Hello?
I can't hear you now, Jay.
You can't hear now? Can you hear me?
I can hear you now, yeah. It just went off.
All right.
This blue light usually shows on my computer, but it's not shown this time for some reason.
All right. Anyhow, do you want to go first or do you want me to go first? Can you hear me?
Can I hear you? I just broke up again then.
If it breaks up, I can hear you, so you just talk if you want to talk. And I'll talk.
Okay.
And I'll type in, let me have a say. But you keep talking, yeah?
Okay.
If you can't hear me, I'll just shut up. You just keep talking, yeah?
Okay. So I'm just reading this book again. The author's John C. Lennox, and the book is entitled The God's Undertaker: Has Science Buried God? And I was just thinking of the book written by Richard Dawkins called The God Delusion that I read some years back. There was him and Sam Harris and Christopher Hitchens and calling themselves the New Atheism. You there, Jay?
Yeah, I can hear him, bro, yeah.
Yeah, okay. But basically, the thesis of Richard Dawkins' book is he believes that any kind of religious faith is a delusion, based on a delusion, because it's not based on evidence. And he felt that faith and religion was dangerous. But my reading and understanding of the book is Dawkins himself was a fundamentalist, because the minute you start making dogmatic statements, you become a fundamentalist yourself.
Yeah.
And I was just reminded by reading this author, John Lennox. He talks about how biblical faith, it's not an absence of evidence, but it's actually a response to evidence. Yeah. It's a response to historical evidence, objective evidence, which is experienced subjectively, personally, in a relationship with God. So biblical faith, it's not blind faith, it's actual opposite.
Yeah.
And he was just pointing out, John Lennox, how actually Dawkins does not provide any evidence himself to show that faith is a delusion. And he's pretty ignorant of the historical roots of science and of Christianity in general. I mean, the ignorance is absolutely, it's almost comical, Jason.
Yeah.
You know, and Alistair McGrath, who wrote a book called The Dawkins Delusion, he claimed that Dawkins had undermined his own position because he failed to engage with any serious Christian thinkers whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's a really good book. And John Lennox, he's basically saying that these new atheism and the skeptics that want nothing to do with faith whatsoever.
Mm.
Again, he points out that they don't really understand the roots in the history of science.
Yeah, yeah.
Or if you want to go a bit deeper, the philosophy of science.
Yeah, yeah.
And he talks about the early pioneers of science, some of the main ones. I mean, Francis Bacon, from 1561 to 1626, he's regarded as one of the fathers of modern science, along with Kepler. There's Pascal, there's Boyle, there's Mendel, there's Newton, there's Kelvin, there's Clerk Maxwell. All these were Christian theists that believed in God. And he basically reminds that this is the key point. At the heart of all science lies the conviction that the universe is orderly.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, the atheists agree that there's order, I think. And the Christian theists believe that there's order. But the distinction is Christian theists believe that the order is due to the fact of God's design. There's been a designer. And Melvin Calvin, he was a Nobel Prize winner in biochemistry. And he basically says the monotheistic belief in God is the historical foundations for modern science.
Yeah, wow.
Because all modern science, you know, is based in the rationality of God.
Yeah.
God being a designer.
Yeah.
He mentions that how many of these Christian scientists, they became scientific because of this belief that God was rational and God had designed the universe. And Francis Bacon talked about how God has given us two revelations. He talked about the law of nature. And the Bible. And what he talked about, he says, if you study nature, it's evidence that there's rationality in nature, there's been a design. And they became scientific basically because the expected law in nature, because they believed in the lawgiver, which was God. So there was the book of nature and the Bible in where rationality is to be found. And so modern science is based on rationality. It's what drove these scientists forward.
Yeah, yeah.
To study it more. Have you got any thoughts, Joe?
Yeah, you said some really interesting things. I thought it was good what you said about Dawkins accusing Christians of having faith, and then noticing that Lennox says that Dawkins has faith. And I think it's really disingenuous for Dawkins and people, atheists like him, who would have that kind of dogmatic attitude and say that Christians who who have faith, well, it's dangerous. And people like Dawkins and an atheist who espouse this, such as people like Aaron Rahr and the Magic Sandwich Show, it shows the lack of scholarship, the lack of real intellectual depth, because only a cursory glance at the philosophy of science, for example, will show you that even a scientist who uses the scientific method has to have faith. There are certain things that a scientist has to have faith. They have to have faith that the sensory perception is reliable. They have to have faith that reality is real. So this idea to say that that faith is a dangerous idea just shows a lack of philosophical sophistication and a lack of depth, really. That's why most academics who are real academics, they respect Dawkins for his work on genetics, but they regard him as a bit of a fundamentalist with his atheism, and they don't take him seriously because of that. So that's the first point. The second point about the history of science, I mean, we mentioned this earlier today. You can even go back for, I mean, you said to me, and it's true, that the Greeks had an influence on the scientific method, and that is true. But also, even in the Middle Ages, I've done videos on this if people want to go and find out, where there were bishops in the Middle Ages who were advocating that we had to go and do investigate nature. And it all stems from the fact that you're right about order and rationality, but also about that nature is good, and we should also that it's worth studying. Whereas other pagan religions and other viewpoints don't put that emphasis on nature, that it is good, which was part of the encouraging people to do science. So right through the Middle Ages, there were bishops calling for doing the scientific method. And we can get into later on these myths that atheists and others have created, historiography, where they try to say that the church has impeded scientific method and science. And we're going to explore some of those myths and show that it wasn't actually the church, that it was actually Aristotelian philosophy, which we'll get into. So, you've made some great points there.
That was another thing as well about what these atheistic fundamentalists do, and others that aren't informed about the real roots of science, is they want to set up a conflict to wipe out faith altogether from society, from schools, from the government, from anything. And so there's a misunderstanding in lay people's minds, Jason, about the myths of conflict. And there's two in particular. One was Galileo and the Roman Catholic Church. And the other was Huxley and Wilberforce. And I just want to read what John Lennox says here. Now, there's a few long words in here that I can't pronounce, but I'll get the main gist of it, I think. But he says this.
What page is it, Mark?
This is page 23.
Yeah.
I just think it's good to read through, Jason.
Yeah.
He says, one of the main reasons for distinguishing clearly between the influence of the doctrine of creation and the influence of other aspects of religious life, and be it said religious politics, on the rise of science is so that we can better understand two of the paradigmatic accounts from history that are often used to maintain the widespread public impression that science has been constantly at war with religion. So they use this debate between Galileo and the Roman Catholic Church to put up a false idea that there's a conflict between religion and science. It says these accounts concern the most famous confrontations in history. The first just mentioned above between Galileo and the Roman Catholic Church. Upon closer inspection, however, both these stories about Galileo and Charles Darwin's Huxley, both these stories fail to support the conflict theses, a conclusion that comes as a surprise to many, but a conclusion nonetheless that has history on its side. Hear me up, Jim.
Yeah, yeah.
He says, first of all, we note the obvious. Galileo appears in our list of scientists who believed in God. He was no agnostic at loggerheads with the theism of his day. Diva Sobel, in her brilliant biography, Galileo's Daughter, effectively debunks this mythical impression of Galileo as a renegade who scoffed at the Bible. It turns out, in fact, that Galileo was a firm believer in God and the Bible, and remained so all of his life. He held that the laws of nature were written by the hand of God in the language of mathematics, and that the human mind is a work of God and one of the most excellent. Furthermore, Galileo enjoyed a great deal of support from the religious intellectuals, at least at the start. The astronomers of the powerful Jesuit educational institution initially endorsed his astronomical work and endorsed him and feted him for it. However, he was vigorously opposed by secular philosophers who were enraged at his criticism of Aristotle. This was bound to cause trouble, but be emphasized not at first with the church, at least in the way that Galileo perceived it. For in his famous letter to the Grand Duchess Christina, he claims that it was the academic professors who were so opposed to him that they were trying to influence the church and authorities to speak out against him. The issue at stake for the professors was clear. Galileo's scientific arguments were threatening the all-pervading Aristotelism of the academy. In the spirit of developing modern science, Galileo wanted to decide theories of the universe on the basis of evidence and not of argument based on appeal to the general authority of Aristotle. Aristotelism was the reigning worldview, not simply the paradigm in which science, but it was a worldview in which cracks were already beginning to appear. Furthermore, the Protestant Reformation was challenging the authority of Rome. From Rome's perspective, religious security was under increasing threat. Then he goes on here, in this bit here. He says, Galileo was never tortured. It should be noted, however, that again, contrary to popular belief, Galileo was never tortured, and his subsequent house arrest was spent for the most part in luxurious private residences belonging to friends. There are important lessons to be gleaned from the Galileo story. First, a lesson for those who are disposed to take the biblical account seriously. It is hard to imagine that there are any today who believe that the earth is the centre of the universe, with the planets and the sun revolving around it. That is, they accept the Copernican view from which Galileo fought, and they do not think that it conflicts with the Bible, although almost everyone at and before the time of Copernicus thought with Aristotle that the earth was at the physical center of the universe.
That's Copernicus, I think, bro.
That's right, Jim. So basically what he's saying is when Galileo looked through his telescope, he claimed that He claimed that the Roman Catholic Church was in the academy. It was dominated by Aristotle.
Yeah.
So the Roman Catholic Church, the way they interpreted the Bible, was through Aristotle's system.
Yeah.
So they actually believed, because they weren't reading it in its literary context. They thought it was talking about they thought the earth moved around the sun.
Oh.
Due to some text they'd not understood in the historical context. And all he was doing, Galileo, he was saying, you're not interpreting the Bible properly because you're looking at it through the lens of Aristotle interpretation.
Yeah.
So it wasn't about the Bible, but the new atheists, basically, they used the argument to say the Bible is ridiculous. Look what happened with Galileo and the Roman Catholic Church.
Yeah.
But what that was about, it was a debate about interpretation.
Yeah.
So it's about correct interpretation. And as Christian theologians, that's what we pursue to do. And so everything was dominated by Aristotle. So it was really Galileo, he wasn't attacking the Bible. He was attacking Aristotle.
And also the Pope allowed him to print his book under, so long as he wouldn't say anything about the Pope. But when he wrote his book, he put some characters in. One of the characters was a caricature of the Pope, and there was some insulting things about the Pope within the book, and he got passed by the Inquisition, passed the book, thinking because it had permission from the Pope that it was okay, so it wasn't read properly. And when it got published, the Pope read it and immediately recognized there were some insults to him, and they were personal insults, insulting his intelligence. And you know, so it was about this Aristotelian philosophy that the Catholic Church had imbibed, and also a personal conflict between Galileo and the Pope, where Galileo was really was unwise in some of the comments that he made concerning the Pope, derogatory comments. But it was nothing to do, like you said, with the Bible. And and yet this myth, as you rightly said, has been used to create in people's minds that there is a conflict between science and religion, because hey, look at how the Catholic Church treated Galileo. And it was nothing to do with science and the Bible. It was to do with Aristotelian philosophy, and it was to do with personal conflict between the Pope and Galileo.
Yeah, that's great. I couldn't have put it. That's why I need you, Jason, to put that clear like that. I would say this as well, Jason. What's amazing as well, right, is people can check these primary sources out themselves.
Mm.
And that's what we, you know, it's always secondary sources, you know. I remember Dr. McGonigal saying to us, he used to say to me all the time, always go back to primary sources.
Mm.
So you can find this out looking at the primary sources, the letters, the personal letters of Galileo. It's just a bit of research. And obviously he's got some secondary sources, and he, John Lennox, but those secondary sources he used will have the primary sources in. So can I just read the second bit as well? The second bit is the Huxley-Wilberforce debate about Darwin. And I'll just read this, Jason.
Yeah, go on, mate.
It says...
is it page 27?
It's page 26, yeah. 27, sorry, 26, page, yeah.
Yeah.
It says...
Just for folk who don't know, we're looking at J.C. Lennox, God's Undertaker, Science Buried God, published by Lions. We're looking at the book and discussing some of its contents. Go on. Yeah.
So this is the Huxley Wilberforce debate. This is used again, Jason, as a false assumption that there's conflict between faith and science. This is what's used as well. Nor in fact does that other frequently cited incident, the debate on the 30th of June 1860 at the British Association for the Advancement of Science, held in Oxford's Natural History Museum, which took place between T.H. Huxley, Darwin's bulldog, and Bishop Samuel Wilberforce, Soapy Sam. The debate was occasioned by a lecture developed by John Draper on Darwin's theory of evolution, The Origin of Species having been published several months earlier. This encounter is often portrayed as a simple clash between science and religion, where the competent scientist convincingly triumphed over the ignorant churchman. Yet historians of science have shown that this account is also very far from the truth. In the first place, Wilberforce was no ignominious. A month after the historic meeting in question, he published a 50-page review of Darwin's work in the Quarterly Review, which Darwin regarded as uncommonly clever. It picks out with skill all the most conjectural parts and brings forward well all the difficulties. It quizzes me most splendidly. Secondly, Wilberforce was no obscurantist. He was determined that the debate should not be between science and religion, but a scientific debate, scientist versus scientist on scientific grounds, an intention which figures significantly in his summary of the review. We have objected to the views with which we are dealing solely on scientific grounds. We have done so from the fixed conviction that it is thus that the truth or falsehood of such arguments should be tried. We have no sympathy with those who object to any facts or alleged facts in nature, or to any inference logically deduced from them, because they believe them to contradict what it appears to them is taught by revelation. So the other debate, it's getting a bit dry. I have a debate, this Huxley and Wilberforce. As to the contemporary accounts of the debate, right, so basically, it's put forward that this Bishop Wilberforce was a laughing stock, Jason.
Yeah.
That he didn't understand Darwin and he was a bit ignorant. In fact, he was a bit scientist himself and he was an academic. So these are historical primary accounts to the real debate. As to contemporary accounts of the debate, John Brooke points out that initially the events seemed to cause little or no stir. It is a significant fact that the famous clash between Huxley and the bishop was not reported by a single London newspaper at the time. So it's not as big as these atheists make out.
Yeah. Can I just come in there just to help, like, just for those who are listening in? Basically, what Mark's saying is this debate between Bishop Wilberforce and Huxley in 1860 was a landmark debate that secularist and evolutionist and atheist used, especially in the modern period of, especially in the 19 from the end of the Victorian period right up into the modern 20th century, and use this as an argument saying the church is just anti-intellectual, behind the times, and can't deal with science, and manufactured that Huxley had won this debate when in reality it wasn't the case, and that Mark's explaining the details of this.
Yeah. So indeed, there are no official records of the meeting, and most of the reports come from Huxley's friends. Huxley himself wrote that there was a inextinguishable laughter among the people at his wit, and I believe that I was the most popular man in Oxford for a full 4 and 20 hours afterwards. However, the evidence is that the debate was far from one-sided. One newspaper later recorded that one previous convert to Darwin's theory was deconverted as he witnessed the debate. The botanist Joseph Hooker grumbled that Huxley didn't put the matter in a form or way that carried the audience, so he had to do it himself. Wilberforce wrote 3 days later to the archaeologist Charles Taylor, "I think I thoroughly beat him." Another report gives the impression that the honours were about even, seeing that Huxley and Wilberforce have each found four men worthy of their esteem. Frank James, a historian at the Royal Institute in London, makes the suggestion that the widespread impression that Huxley was victorious may well have arisen because Wilberforce was not well liked, a fact that is missing from most of the accounts. Had Wilberforce not been so unpopular in Oxford, he would have carried the day and not Huxley. Shades of Galileo. On careful analysis, then, two of the main props commonly used to support the conflict thesis crumble. Indeed, research has undermined that thesis to such an extent that historian of science Colin Russell can come to the following general conclusion. The common belief that the actual relation between religion and science over the last few centuries have been marked by deep and enduring hostility is not only historically inaccurate, but actually a caricature so grotesque that what needs to be explained is how it could possibly have achieved any degree of respectability. It is clear, therefore, that powerful forces must have been at play. In order to account for the depth to which the conflict myth has become embedded in the popular mind, and indeed there were, as in the case of Galileo, the real issue at stake was not simply a question of the intellectual merits of a scientific theory. Once more, institutional power played a key role. Huxley was on a crusade to ensure the supremacy of the emerging new class of professional scientists against the privileged position of the clerics, however intellectually gifted. He wanted to make sure that he was the scientist who wielded the levers of power. The legend of a conquered bishop slain by a professional scientist suited that crusade, and it was exploited to the full. However, it is apparent that even more was involved. A central element in Huxley's crusade is highlighted by Michael Poole. He writes, "In this struggle, the concept of nature was spelt with a capital N. Huxley vested Dame Nature, as he called her, with attributes ascribed to God." I don't know what that's talking about there. Conclusion is, thus a mythical conflict was and still often is hyped up and shamelessly used as a weapon in another battle. The real one this time, that is, that between naturalism and theism. You still there, Jay?
Yeah.
So basically, what we've looked at is the two false conflicts put forward historically, used as that there's a conflict between science and faith, and those are the Galileo episode and the Huxley episode. But you just have to go back to primary sources. Is that right, Jason?
Yeah.
And check it yourself. It's all there to check and get a balanced view of what really happened. But he goes on, the real debate is this, Jason, is the real debate is between two worldviews, isn't it? When you talk about atheism, and theism or Christianity or what other faith. And it's simply this, the worldview of atheism is naturalism. That's a worldview. And naturalism basically is all we have is matter. Matter exists. So there's no supernatural at all. It's just matter. And obviously the Christian worldview is there's the supernatural. You know, matter is not all there is. You know, God created matter. So it's about two worldviews. One where everything is explained by naturalism, and the other by the other by a belief in a supernatural, you know, supreme being. Do you know anything else about naturalism, Jay?
Page 29. For the sake of clarity, we note that naturalism is related to, but not identical with, materialism, although they are sometimes very hard to tell apart. The Oxford Companion to Philosophy says that the complexity of the concept of matter has meant that the various materialist philosophies have tended to substitute for matter some notion like whatever it is that can be studied by the methods of natural science, thus turning materialism into naturalism, though it would be an exaggeration to say the two outlooks have simply coincided. Materialists are naturalists, but they are naturalists who hold that mind and consciousness are to be distinguished from matter. They regard the former as emergent phenomena that is dependent on matter, but occurring on a higher level, which is not reducible to the lower level properties of matter. There are also other naturalists who hold that the universe consists purely of mind stuff. Naturalism, however, in common with materialism, stands opposed to supernaturalism, insisting that the world of nature should form a single sphere without intrusion from outside by souls or spirits, divine or human. Whatever their differences, materialism and naturalism are therefore intrinsically atheistic. So that's page 29. So I thought that that was helpful. I think that naturalism is falling on hard times at the moment philosophically. There are philosophers and academics out there who are beginning to get tired of this this kind of closed system, where they believe nothing can break into this closed system. And the reason why academics and philosophers are getting tired is because studies in neuroscience on the brain and looking at consciousness, it becomes clear every day that science can't get to the bottom of what consciousness is. And it's because of things like that that people like Thomas Nagel, an American philosopher, and other academic philosophers are moving away from naturalism and trying to think of other ways of looking at things. And basically, it's the old adage, I think, is nature cannot carry the weight of explaining itself. Rationality is too big a topic for nature to explain. The beginning of the universe is too big a thing to explain for nature to explain, and nature can't carry that weight. And once you start to use nature to try to understand the origins of nature and some of the more profounder questions, nature fails, and you have to posit something bigger than nature. So for example, we see within nature rationality, we can see that. So you know, we can investigate the universe and find knowledge within the universe that implies rationality within the universe, and nature can't explain why there is rationality. Another example is order. There is order within the universe, and if you believe that there was a big bang, a singularity which came by pure chance, why is there order? How can there be order when you're operating on chance? Nature can't explain these things, and you have to begin to posit something outside nature, and that's why naturalism fails.
He concludes with this, Jason. He says the key issue we repeat, sorry, Plus, the key issue is not so much the relationship of the discipline of science to that of theology, but the relationship of science to the various worldviews held by scientists, in particular, to naturalism and theism. When we ask if science has buried God, we are talking at the level of the interpretation of science. What we are really asking is, which worldview does science support, naturalism or theism? Mm. And that's an important question, that.
Yeah, yeah.
Because we've been saying that the Christian vision, we talk of worldviews is, you know, a worldview is something that shapes your outlook.
Yeah.
You could call it vision. The Christian vision or the atheistic vision, right? Which vision of life, which vision of humanity makes sense, which vision of life makes sense of reality the best, makes sense of the world? And that's what you've got to ask. He says this, he says this quote, this is by Sir Peter Medawar, and he said, "The existence of a limit to science is, however, made clear by its inability to answer childlike elementary questions having to do with first and last things. Questions such as, how did everything begin? What are we all here for? And what is the point of living?" And the science can give the how, but it can't give the why, can it?
Yeah, yeah, that's true. I think you've hit the nail on the head about it. It is this conflict between theism and naturalism. It's an interpretation. You know, people will go on like these evolutionists and atheists and whatever. I just want to say quickly that there are some atheists that are not materialist. They're not pure naturalists. They can have like some kind of mystical understanding of the universe, kind of like Buddhist. But they're very few and far between, but most atheists would come under the banner of materialist and naturalism. But it is a conflict of interpretation. I mean, the atheist and evolutionist will say, you know, we have the facts about evolution or whatever. But I think it goes before we even get there. It's a philosophical interpretation of how we see reality. And what the naturalist is doing is making a philosophical assumption. It's saying, it's philosophically assuming that all there is nature. And that is an assumption. You can never say, if you're being intellectually honest, that all there is nature. You would have to be open to the possibility that there would be more than nature. So naturalism, if you're a naturalist, you're making a philosophical assumption and then basing everything from that. With theism, we're not just making an assumption. We're saying that looking at reality, looking at nature, looking at, for example, DNA, where there is information within DNA, complex information, when we're looking at logic and reason, when we're looking at morals, that a naturalistic explanation of these things just doesn't wash. It breaks down. And that's why what explains these things is theism. So theism fits reality better than the assumption of naturalism that that can't stand up to any scrutiny. Okay, it has got no explanatory power because it's not explaining the big things within nature.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I think. I don't know.
Yeah. I was reminded of when I think it was John McCarthy, he mentioned that about that scientist called Herbert Spencer. And he talked about, he says, everything that exists in the universe can be explained in five categories. And he said it was time, force, action, space, and matter. So he says all reality consists in those five categories. And then he talked about how in the first verse of the Bible, those categories are there. So for example, you've got in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. That's the first verse of Genesis. So in the beginning, that's time. God, that's force. Created, that's action. The heavens, that's space, and the earth, that's matter. And I mean, how amazing is that? I think he was around in the 1800s, wasn't he?
I don't know. That sounds good to me, bro.
Herbert Spencer, yeah. It's amazing. But, you know, all the scientists were getting excited about it. You know, thinking they'd found something new, but he was there in Genesis. So, but I don't think I've got anything else to say. Just, I would recommend anyone to read this book, mate. John C. Lennox, God's Undertaker, as science buried God. And to check it out and get a correct historical overview between these debates between Galileo, because it all comes down to interpretation, doesn't it? No, it was about interpretation between Galileo and the Roman Catholic Church and the secular academics. It's about interpretation between Huxley and Wilberforce. It's about an interpretation of worldviews, naturalism, or theism. Everything comes down to that interpretation. But yeah, I'll just end it there, I think, Jason.
All right, I've got a few quotes here that I could read and tell me what you think. I find this really helpful. Page 59.
Oh yeah.
Just a couple of more quotes, if that's all right.
That's fine, Jim.
Page 59.
However, we can keep talking about it if you want.
What, bro? What did you say, bro?
You can keep talking about it if you want, Jay. It's fine with me.
However much, page 59, right at the bottom, however much we may debate the essence of the scientific method, there is no question as to the foundation on which that method rests, the rational intelligibility of the universe. It was Albert Einstein's astonishment at this that prompted him to make the famous comment, "The most incomprehensible thing about the universe is that it is comprehensible." End of quote. The very concept of the intelligibility of the universe presupposes the existence of a rationality capable of recognizing that intelligibility. Indeed, confidence in human mental processes possess some degree of reliability and are capable of giving us some information about the world is fundamental to any kind of study, not only the study of science. This conviction is so central to all thinking that we cannot even question its validity without assuming it in the first place, since we have to rely on our minds in order to do the questioning. It is the bedrock belief upon which all intellectual inquiry is built. I shall argue that theism gives it a consistent and reasonable justification, whereas naturalism seems powerless to do so. He goes on, rational intelligibility is one of the main considerations that have led thinkers of all generations to conclude that the universe must itself be a product of intelligence. Philosopher Keith Ward sums up, to the majority of those who have reflected deeply and written about the origin and nature of the universe, it has seemed that it points beyond itself to a source which is non-physical and of great intelligence and power. Almost all the great classical philosophers, certainly Plato, Aristotle, Descartes, Leibniz, Spinoza, Kant, Hegel, Locke, and Berkeley, saw the origin of the universe as lying in a transcendent reality. They had different specific ideas of this reality and different ways of approaching it, but that the universe is not self-explanatory and that it requires some explanation beyond itself was something they accepted as fairly obvious. Thus, the inference to the best explanation from the origin and nature of the universe to an underlying non-physical intelligence has a long and impressive pedigree. And I was just thinking of the atheist Anthony Flew, who didn't become a theist, but as the leading atheist in the 20th century, he began at the end of his life to look, when he was about 80, to look at nature, and he began to realize with all the learning about DNA and the complexity of DNA, that he began to see there must be an intelligence behind that. And that led him to move to deism, that there was a God who created things and set it in motion and sat back. And he didn't move to theism, but he was moving in that direction because he saw that the universe showed rationality. So I don't know what you think about that.
Yeah. Well, I just have this point with that, Jay, what you just said. He goes on after that to talk about the nature and role of faith in science. And he says this here. He says, Professor of Mathematics Sir Roger Penrose, whose understanding of that relationship was unquestioned, has this to say about it. It is hard for me to believe that such superb theories could have arisen merely by some random natural selection of ideas, leaving only the good ones. The good ones are simply much too good to be the survivors of ideas that have arisen in a random way. There must be instead some deep underlying reason for the accord between mathematics and physics. Certainly, science itself cannot account for this phenomenon. Why? Because in the words of John Polkinghorne, science does not explain the mathematical intelligibility of the physical world. Oh. For it is part of science's founding faith that this is so. We cannot fail to note that here we have two leading scientists explicitly drawing our attention to the foundational role that faith plays in science. Yes, faith. This may come as a surprise.
Hello, Mark, your connection's gone down, mate. Hello? I'll just phone Mark back in a sec. Hope everybody's okay. Hi, bro.
Hey, yeah.
Yeah. Just missed you about that mathematical science bit.
Oh, yeah. This may come as a shock to many, especially if you have been exposed to the very common fallacy mentioned at the beginning of this book and spread with speed by Richard Dawkins and others, that faith means blind faith and belongs exclusively to the domain of religion, whereas science does not involve faith at all. Dawkins is simply wrong. Faith is inseparable from the scientific endeavor. Gödel's second theorem gives further evidence for this. You cannot even do mathematics without faith and it's consistency. So it goes back to that, you know, it's about faith in worldviews, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
Some have faith that naturalism explains reality and gives meaning to life, and some believe that theism does.
I think what it is that there are foundations within your worldview, within your position, that you can't prove evidentially. So for example, you know, how can I put it? You've got to start somewhere in your system. There's got to be somewhere where you begin. We begin with God. The naturalist begins with nature. And that's the starting point. Cutting back all the evidence, that's where we start. But we can test that starting point. We can see which makes sense of reality. And what we're saying is that if you start with nature, and we ask questions about nature, like why is the universe show rationality? How does nature explain that? And it breaks down, it can't answer that question. And we ask, well, if there's rationality in nature, how does theism answer that? How does a God answer that? Well, the answer is that God is rational, and it talks about he made the world, he made the universe, so it's made in reflecting his glory, and that's why there is rationality within the universe. So you what I'm saying is you take the starting point of naturalism and the starting point of theism, and then do an internal critique and see which ones match up to reality, which ones explain reality. And Christianity, the theism, explains these big questions like rationality. For example, the fact that there's fine tuning in the universe. If you take naturalism, how does that explain why there's fine tuning? Well, it implodes on itself because naturalism began by chance. So how do you get order from chance? It's not consistent. Whereas our position is that theism, God is a God. Sorry, mate. Our position is that God is a God. Can you hear me now?
Now I can, yeah. I missed the last couple of minutes.
Our position is that God is a God of order, and so therefore he created the universe, and that's why there are these the constants within the universe where we can have life here on Earth. So I was just saying that you just do an internal critique of theism and naturalism breaks down. Basically, that's what I was saying, Mark. Can you hear me?
Yeah. It keeps going off a bit, Jay.
All right.
Can you just summarise again what you were just saying there?
I was just saying that every system has...
Yeah.
Every belief system, whatever it is, atheism or Christianity, there's always a starting point, and that starting point can't be proved evidentially. Your presupposition, like if the atheist, if the naturalist says all there is nature, right? Well, that's just an assumption. You can't prove it like evidentially. You assume that, yeah. And our starting point is the Trinitarian God, that God is a triune God, and it's our starting point. We could provide evidences, but ultimately it's just our starting point. And so what you can do then is you can do an internal critique of whose starting point makes sense. So you take the nature and you test the starting points with reality. So the naturalist will say that all there is
Hold off again, James.
All right. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
I've just heard you there, yeah.
So I'm just saying that we're doing in terms...
Can you now?
You can't hear me? Can you hear me?
I can now.
All right. I'll just if you can't hear me, I'll just keep going and explain it again. And
all right.
So basically what I'm saying is you take naturalism and you take theism and you look at reality and you see which one explains reality. And just take rationality. There is a rationality within the universe. There is order in the universe, and naturalism cannot explain that rationality, and it cannot explain it cannot explain that order. Yet theism makes sense with rationality in the universe, because it talks about God made the universe and God's rational, and that's why we can see rationality within the universe. And God's a God of order, and that's why we see order in the universe and the constants. And so we're just doing internal critique, and naturalism implodes on itself. Did you get that? Hello? Sorry.
Yeah, Jay.
Yeah, did you get that, bro?
No, I'm not forgetting.
All right. All right, well, shall we... Anyhow, do you want to say anything else?
I didn't get that, Jay.
Do you want to say anything else? It don't matter if you didn't get that. If you want to say anything else that comes to your mind, and
what was that, Jay?
I was just saying, is there anything else you want to say about whatever, anything? I'll ring you back.
You there, Jay?
I'll ring you back. I'll ring you back. So, if anybody's got any questions you want to ask, I'll put the So if you want to ask questions, I'll just phone Mark back, see if I can get him. See if he phones me back. I'll just wait for him to phone me back. So, yeah. So, I'm going over to... the video. So, if you want to ask questions... fire away. Ask us questions. And see if I can get Mark to answer. So, see if there's any. Oops. Just trying to phone Mark back. That was a good conversation with Mark. I enjoyed that. So let's see if anybody's asked any questions. Is anybody asking any questions?
I need you.
Hi, Mark. You okay, bro?
Yeah.
Have you got any last thoughts, mate?
I just think for me, this book should be on everyone's shelf.
It's dynamite, isn't it?
Yeah, that's all I've got to say.
It is dynamite.
Yeah, I don't know how anybody can not read this book and, you know, and not be challenged. You know, it's just, everyone should read it.
What would you say to those who would say that? Hello?
Hey, Jay, how are you?
What would you say to those who would say, well, you're getting all excited about John Lennox and this book, but he was he's a theistic evolutionist. What would you say about to that?
I don't know, Jason, to be honest. I think if he loves Jesus, if he loves Jesus and wants to follow Jesus, I think that's good enough for me. Like, no. What would you say?
I would say personally, he that he's provided in the book so far what I've read. Ammunition.
It's breaking up again, Jay.
Can't you hear me?
No, it's gone off.
Can you hear me? Hello?
Just keep talking, Jay. You're all right.
All right. I would say that basically his book provides powerful ammunition against evolution. And I think that secretly, he doesn't really believe in evolution, that he has to believe in evolution, theistic evolution, to keep his academic career. But he's provided within the book solid ammunition against evolution.
Ooh.
That's what I would say, Mark. Did you hear that?
Yeah, I got that, yeah.
And that's...
Well, it's definitely against evolution from an atheistic point of view, where there's no God at all.
Yeah. So I think it's an awesome book, and I think it's absolutely devastating. But I think it's,
yeah,
I do think it's also, I know what you're saying, but I think it's also devastating to evolution, because you can take the things that he's saying and you can apply it against evolution, as in evolution, the evolutionary process, I think. Well, that's just me anyway. I'll shut up now. Can you hear me, bro? I just phoned Mark back. Okay, folks, I'm gonna end the show now, and I want to thank everybody for coming to listen. I've really enjoyed it tonight. So watch out for a few more Google Hangouts every now and again, and watch out for sermons and lectures and Google Hangouts from time to time. And God bless you. Thanks for listening. Please leave your questions underneath the video. We'll try and get back to you at some later stage. And love to everybody out there, and stay firm in the faith. Don't forget to get hold of the book, God's Undertaker, Has Science Buried God, by John C. Lennox, published by Lion. Me and Mark have read many, many books, and we think this is an awesome book, and everybody should read it. Okay, thank you for listening, and God bless you, and see you soon. Thank you for listening. God bless.